Hello everyone, and welcome to the very final lecture about the vibrations of strings. In this lecture, I will discuss with you the forced vibrations in strings. So for this, we require the equation of motion where we now include the right-hand side. This F, which might be a function of x and t, is the distributed load acting on the string. I have also given the boundary conditions and initial conditions, but I have to say here that since we are looking at the steady state solution, we don't really need the initial conditions for this. So I will first explain to you how to do this in general, and after that I apply it on an example. And the example that I'm going to look into is that we have a point force acting at halfway the string, and that this force is harmonic. So we have some force F cosine omega t right there. All right, so that will be the specific example. Now, we start off by recalling the modal expansion, which was that v as a function of x and t can be written as the infinite sum of mode shapes times their corresponding modal coordinates, eta I. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to substitute this into the equation of motion, and now I will carry along this force F. So we start off by an infinite sum of rho A Vi times eta I double dot. Then we have an infinite sum of T times Vi double prime eta I itself, and in the right hand side we just have this F. Now, I'm going to multiply the entire equation by Vj and then integrate over the length of the string. And this second term, the stiffness term, I will manipulate using integration by parts, similarly as what we did before. So this becomes the infinite sum of rho A and then the integral of Vj times Vi dx times eta I double dot, and due to integration by parts this becomes a plus I is 1 to infinity of t times the integral from 0 to L of Vj prime Vi prime dx times eta I itself, and this is now equal to the right hand side, also contains this integral, and Vj f dx. Okay, now let's recall the orthogonality conditions, because these infinite series, these infinite sums, all have zero contributions except for I is j, and since we mass normalize the modes, this the term in front of the eta I double dot simply becomes 1. So we get eta I double dot, and then the term in front of eta I itself equals omega I squared. All right, and the right hand side now for I equals j can be written as some modal force qi. So this is I is 1, 2, and so on. So this is actually a very similar form, or exactly the same form, of the modal equations that we encountered for discrete systems, where this qi is the modal force, or generalized modal force, and it equals the integral from 0 to L Vi, because I equals j, f dx. So I would say solving these modal equations is very similar, and the key challenge in this procedure, I would say, is determining this modal force Q. Because once we know Q, we know how to solve the modal equations using Estoff techniques. So then we know eta I as a function of time. We back substitute it in the modal expansion, and then we have V. So that is already everything about the general theory. Let's have a look about this specific example now. Because I looked at a point load, whereas this modal force is only expressed in terms of the distributed load F. So there is, if we want to do this really accurate, I need to split the string into two segments, but and this will result in a lot of work, but I can basically find a workaround where I will say, well, in this case, this distributed load can be written as the point load, so that is F times the cosine of omega t, times the Dirac function, the Dirac delta function of x minus L over 2. So this basically specifies that the distribution is zero everywhere, except at L over 2, in the neighborhood of L over 2, where it is infinitely high in such a way that the integral equals f times cosine omega t. Yeah, so recall for the Dirac function, that the Dirac of x minus a, well, in fact, what do we know for this? Well, it is zero everywhere for x not a, and it is infinite at x is a, in such a way that if we integrate this function over a domain that includes a, the result is 1. Okay, so I'm going to make use of this. Because let's substitute this into the expression for the modal force, okay? Then I need the expression for the modes. Okay, the expression for the modes in this case, Vn was alpha sine of n pi x over L, where alpha was the square root of 2 divided by rho al. That was the expression for alpha for which we obtain mass normalization. Good. So upon substitution, and I will switch indices now from I to n, because I think it's more convenient, we obtain that Qn, which will be in the end only a function of time, equals f times alpha times the integral from 0 to L of the mode shape, so sine of n pi x over L, times the Dirac function of x minus L over 2, dx, times the cosine of omega t. Now, using this properties of the Dirac function, I can show that this integral is nothing more than just the mode shape evaluated at L over 2. So that means that this can be written as f times alpha times the sine. And then if we substitute for x L over 2, we just have n pi divided by 2 times the cosine of omega times t. So in the end, this is just everything that remains from this long integral. Okay, so if you're not happy with that, spend some more time in working out this integral using this property of the Dirac function right here. Okay, good. So now we know the modal force. That means that the modal equations become eta n double dot plus omega n squared times eta n is f times alpha times the sine of n pi divided by 2 times the cosine of omega t. So this is indeed a function only in time, and which is harmonic. And the solution using standard Estov techniques for eta n as a function of time is, I would say, relatively straightforward. It is f times alpha times omega n squared minus omega squared in the denominator. In the numerator is 1. Then we have sine of n pi divided by 2 times the cosine of omega t. So again, here you see that for establishing this solution, we rely on S-TOF techniques. For that, it's really important that you master these S-TOF techniques. If you don't see how I end up with this relation, have a look again at my lecture on forced vibrations for systems with 1 degree of freedom, or for now, just differentiate this solution twice, back substitute it into the modal equation, and then see that it works. All right. So I will continue with this solution for the modal coordinates. I think it's interesting that you see here that the response is a function in time that is with the same frequency from this sine n pi divided by 2. You can again see that only odd-numbered mode shapes will have a non-zero contribution. And that is again because the excitation is symmetric. So the fact that this force applies in the middle exactly only excite modes that have a non-zero deflection there. And all the modes with an even mode number, so the second mode, the fourth mode, and so on, they all have a node in the center, and therefore they cannot be excited by this force. So that can be seen from this sign. You can also see that we have this omega n squared minus omega squared in the denominator, and that means that resonance occurs whenever the excitation frequency equals one of the infinitely many natural frequencies. Okay. So by back substitution, we have the expression for V as a function of x and t, which is the infinite sum of the mode shapes times the corresponding coordinates. So that will be the infinite sum of n equal to 1 all the way to infinity of f alpha squared, because Vn also contains an alpha, times this fraction, this ratio, times the sine of n pi over 2, times the mode shapes, these are the sines of n pi x divided by L, times the cosine of omega t. Okay. And if I now substitute the solution for alpha in here, because alpha squared is known due to the mass normalization, we get that the total solution is the infinite sum of 2f divided by rho al. And then we have omega n squared minus omega squared 1. Then we have sine n pi over 2 sine n pi x over L cosine of omega t. And this is the forced vibration response for the case that we have a point force harmonic in the center. Let me make a straight line out of this as well. Good. So again, here you can see the behavior in time. This here is the modes, so these contain the shape of the string, and this over here is you can interpret it as a modal participation, where you can see that only the odd-numbered modes contribute. And from the fact that we have this ratio, you can see that, well, for a given omega, for a known excitation frequency, you can see that for natural frequencies that are much higher than this excitation frequency, this denominator will be a large number. So also here you see that this denominator is the smallest for natural frequencies that are close to the excitation frequency. So these modes will contribute most to the solutions. Frequencies that are way lower or way higher than the excitation frequency only contribute to very limited extent. So that means that in practical circumstances, you would check what is the excitation frequency of this external load, and then it is sufficient to take into account only a finite number of mode shapes up to this excitation frequency, maybe a couple of more higher, and then the rest can be ignored. And then you still have a very good approximation of the total solution with only a finite number of mode shapes. All right, so I think this concludes the lecture on forced vibrations. You can see here that the most challenging part is actually to come up with this modal force Q. Once you know it, you can solve the entire problem by relying on your skills of solving single degree of freedom systems. This also concludes the entire series on the vibrations of strings. I hope you liked it. Thank you very much for watching.